My name is Andrew Stotz, and I'll be your host as we continue our journey into the teachings of Dr. W. Edwards Deming. Today, I'm here with featured guest, John Dews. John, are you ready to share your Deming journey?
Yeah, Andrew, I'm really glad to be here and looking forward to speaking with you today.
We've been talking about, you know, this for a while, and so it's exciting to kick it off. So let me introduce you to the audience. Ladies and gentlemen, John A. Dews is an accomplished education systems leader and improvement science scholar practitioner with more than two decades of experience. He is the chief learning officer of the United Schools Network, where he directs the network's continual improvement fellowship and serves as an improvement advisor. He draws heavily on the work of Dr. W. Edwards Deming and his system of profound knowledge. He's currently continuing his education through the Improvement Advisor Program at the Institute for Healthcare Improvement in Boston, Massachusetts. John, can you take a little bit and tell us about the story, about how you first learned about the teachings of Dr. W. Edwards Deming and what hooked you?
Yeah, happy to do that. I'm about 20 years into my career as an educator, and I sort of think about my career across four stages or so. Stage zero, as a teacher, I didn't really know anything about classroom management or how to lead a class. It was a lot of trial and error type learning. And then I sort of started to figure stuff out over time. And stage one, sort of, I transitioned into now working at a series of public charter schools. I was on the founding team of seven schools or nonprofits, sort of in this next stage. And I think a lot of my learning was sort of what I would call subject matter learning. So cognitive science, curriculum and lesson planning, how to use data to drive instruction, those types of things. And then about 2016 or so, I started learning about improvement science. I got an email, mentioned a book called Learning to Improve, and that got me sort of started on this path to learning the tools of improvement science. And I did that for 4 or 5 years. And then about a couple of years ago, I stumbled across the W. Edwards Deming Institute website. And I had previously come to the website a couple of years earlier. Truth be told, I went to the System of Profound Knowledge page. It didn't make a lot of sense to me. And so I sort of let it lay for a year or two, and I came back to it in 2020. And not that all of a sudden it made sense, but there was something there that sparked this interest that's been going on for 3 years now, where I've devoured books, listened to interviews, and really gone on this journey to learn exactly what Dr. Deming was talking about with his system of profound.
And when you think about the improvements that you were trying to do or the problems that you were trying to solve, and then you started to see, let's say, the system of profound knowledge, what was it that stood out as, oh, that explains why, this is happening. That explains why. What were some of those revelations and things that you could then bring back to your work? I'm just curious, like, how did that unfold?
Yeah, I mean, it took some time. I mentioned sort of discovering the Institute website in about 2018 or so, and sort of it not initially making a lot of sense. There's probably two things. One, candidly, I saw System of Profound Knowledge, and I was like, well, who talks like that? What is that? Like, who calls their stuff profound knowledge? And then sort of the second thing was, when I sort of looked over the four components, systems theory and the theory of variation and theory of knowledge and psychology, frankly, most of it was incomprehensible to me. And a couple of years later, I come back, I'm a little further into this learning journey, and I go back to it. Not that I had any type of sort of, instant revelation or anything like that. It's taken a lot of deep study. It did start to slowly make sense. And what I realized in one of the books I was reading is sort of this idea that there's these two complementary types of knowledge. One is sort of subject matter knowledge. So in my case, it's those things I mentioned, knowing how to plan lessons, know how to do classroom management, the things that an educator that needs to know how to do. And then there's this whole other bucket of knowledge, which I realized when Deming said system of profound knowledge, he meant the components interact. That's the system part. And then the profound part is just that you have a deep knowledge about your organization across those four components. And I realized there's this whole other sort of bucket of knowledge that we're not attending to that tells us some of the most important information we need to know about our organizations. And it's only when you bring those two things together, the subject matter knowledge with the profound knowledge, that you actually then can transform your organizations. And so that realization along the way was a big part of the sort of latching on to Dr. Deming's philosophy. And I'd say the second thing that I did very early on, besides reading the books and listening to a lot of the Deming Institute podcast interviews, was I started talking to people that appeared on those interviews. And so I reached out to Kelly Allen, and then he turned me on to David Langford, who's probably the guy doing Deming in education, and started relationships with both of them. And they were very, very generous with their time and expertise. And that really allowed me to clarify my thinking. Now, because I have this expert in Deming's philosophy helping sort of to guide me, answer questions, and sort of that rounded out some of the knowledge I was doing in my self-study.
Which I guess accelerates things. I mean, that's it's in my age, when I was young, I sat into two seminars with Dr. Deming, you know, teaching. And yeah, okay, that answered a lot of questions, but we don't have that luxury anymore. So it's got to be, number one, reading the materials, watching the videos and all that, right, but also checking our understanding. And I know both Kelly and David are great resources. Kelly helped me when I was writing my book, Transform Your Business with Dr. Deming's 14 Points, to help me, you know, think about things. And I know there's even more, you know, so much more to learn. And I think that's where what I think about the profound knowledge aspect. And I think what you said was like, there's kind of, you have to have these two components, and it's subject matter expert, you know, that's just a given when you're teaching, and understanding how to teach. But then this whole other thing about the system aspect of it, you know, the psychology aspect of that. And I have a question for you about education. Let's say I graduated from high school, from a pretty good, you know, public high school in Ohio. And I'm just curious, like, if we went back to that school today and, you know, I spent, you know, I don't know what it was, 7 hours a day at school, you know, arrive at 8 and leave at 3 or whatever that was. I spent X amount of time at school, and I accumulated X amount of knowledge during that time. And my question to you is, if we go now from 1983, when I graduated, to here we are 50 years later or so, or 50 years later. So now we're here we are in the future with so much knowledge, so much experience. Are students attending attending high school for either the same time and accumulating much more knowledge, or are they attending school for a much shorter time and accumulating the same amount of knowledge, or are we doing the same thing?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think there's sort of a relevant Deming quote that's something to the effect of experience teaches nothing, right? And it's, you know, basically you're saying you have to have an underlying theory, and then you build the knowledge in testing that theory and see how it works in the real world. So in a lot of respects, I think you know, in the, 40 years or so since you were in high school, probably a lot of schools haven't changed much. They sort of do the same thing year in and year out. So they're not really learning their, like I said, across that 40-year time period, it's just sort of a repetition. Now, of course, if you went into that high school, there'd be differences like the type of technology you would see in classrooms. I think, by and large, when you're talking about school effectiveness, and people will argue about this, I think depending on how you're measuring that outcome, I think that schools are, generally speaking, better maybe than they were 40 years ago. Mm. Now, the problem is that better typically means that test scores are better. And of course, there's variation in this in both time and place. And the variation, I don't think it's linear. I mean, I think there are ups and downs in different places based on a whole host of factors like the pandemic or, even the there's less spending in schools out of the 2008 hiring crisis, or sorry, housing crisis, and those had an impact on things like test scores. But I think what Deming, and he was very interested, obviously, in education. He was a professor for 50 years, as you know, at New York University. He, the subtitle of his last book had education in the subtitle. What he was really talking about when he was thinking about talking about education was transformation. And that was like a complete change in state. And so when I hear your question, that's what I think of. I think of, have schools, if they know the Deming philosophy, have they undergone a transformation following Deming's teachings? And I would say, by and large, the answer to that question, notwithstanding the sort of test score question, the answer to the transformation question is no. Mm-hmm. I think by and large, that's not what I've seen across my career.
And if we think about a person listening into this conversation who's an educator and they're looking for new answers to maybe old problems, and they come across this podcast, they come across the material like you did, what's the hope that you can provide to them about how they could benefit either individually by thinking about and learning about Dr. Deming's teachings for their performance as a teacher or as an administrator? And what hope or excitement can you provide them if they're an administrator of a school thinking, this is interesting. Maybe this could provide me some things that I need to start to think differently about it. Tell me a little bit about kind of the journey of you then learning about Deming and then start to bringing it into your institution.
Yeah, I mean, there's a few things that I think of. So one thing is, if I've discovered the Deming philosophy and I'm an educator, how do I bring that to my school, or how do I bring that to my classroom? Or if I'm a systems leader, how do I bring that to my school district? And I think one of the things that I learned from David is you preach to the masses and work with the willing. And so, thinking about intrinsic motivation, which I know David has talked about on your podcast, is you want people to opt into going on this sort of learning journey with you. So that's one thing I think of. The second thing I think of is, and this was from David as well, when he started doing the Deming philosophy in his classroom and using the system of profound knowledge, he was a classroom teacher. And so everybody has this circle of influence, this circle that they have control over. And in his case, he didn't have control over the school building, the high school where he was. He didn't have control over the school district at the time, but he did have control over his classroom. And it was basically through applying the Deming ideas in his classroom that people started coming and saying, hey, what are you doing in here? There's something very different that's going on here. And then the principal got so interested in it. He said, I'd like you to sort of teach people how to do this building wide. And he became the director of continuous improvement there at his high school in Alaska. And then ultimately, he was encouraged by Deming to go off and consult across the world to sort of bring these ideas to schools all over the world. So I think that's another thing that I think of. I also think that in some sort of ways, you can learn aspects of the Deming philosophy and start to apply them tomorrow. So I think about something like knowledge about variation. I may know nothing about the technical aspects of a control chart, for example, but what I can do is I can take any data that I have that occurs across time and just plot those dots on a simple line chart and start to understand what that data looks like versus having those numbers in a spreadsheet. And then there's other aspects that do take time. I think one thing that Deming said in one of his books was there's no instant pudding. And basically he meant that when it comes to organizational transformation, you're talking about a 4 or 5 or even 10-year journey and beyond to get this to take root in an organization. At the same time, it doesn't take 1,000 people. And I heard David talk about this, and I heard Deming talk about this idea of you need to capture and educate and sort of bring along about the square root of the number of people in your organization that really have a strong grasp of the system of profound knowledge. And so if you're in a roughly 100-person organization like mine, I need 10 people that have learned these ideas and are interested in spreading them to their classroom or to their school or, in our case, into the network as a whole.
And how did it go finding those people? And as you say, it's a voluntary, you want those people to come, you want to attract them, attraction rather than promotion. How did that journey go for you internally?
Well, it's definitely ongoing. Definitely ongoing. And I think it's going really well. It's a process. We're probably about 2 years into that process. And so in some ways, it's now a core part of who we are. So a good example of that is going back to, this idea of knowledge about variation. 2 years ago, none of us had any knowledge of what a control chart or a process behavior chart was. And now we have dashboards that are shared system-wide on all kinds of measures that are important to us, where we're now looking at data over time and realizing that until we sort of understand the sort of the patterns that we see in that data, we don't really know anything about whatever that area is. So that's something that's taken hold, and we've spread it pretty quickly across the network. Before we would say we overreact to maybe like a single test score, or attendance is down this month. Now we step back and say, okay, what does that look like over 12 months or 15 or 20 months? What are the patterns? Is it sort of common cause? Is it just a part of our system? Or is there a signal here that we need to pay attention to? So, and many aspects like that, it's taken hold. And in other aspects, it does take longer to implement. And, a good example there is Deming said abolish grades. And, he was pretty unequivocal about that. He didn't give grades in his graduate statistical courses at NYU. That's a much harder thing to change. It's a much harder thing to get people to understand why he said that. I mean, even for myself to learn sort of, why did he say that? Is it feasible? What's the replacement? Those all have, there's practical considerations when you're in a, you're in a school system. You have to give grades. You have to have report cards, or, you think you do anyway. And so things like that take time, and we're not there yet on some of Deming's ideas, like, abolishing grades or changing our sort of grading.
It's interesting. I mean, one of the beautiful things about having a private company is that you can implement these things without kind of regulatory oversight or, that type of stuff. You just can implement it. And so there's an enormous constraint in that field. Now, let me ask you about the charts that you talk about. I want to ask two questions. First question is, from your experience of looking at different charts related to education, if someone's listening to this, that it is working in a school or a classroom or whatever, they're looking at it, what would be one chart that you think that they could start on today and implement? And That's the first question I have. And the second one is about, you know, how do you prevent people from obsessing about the data in a chart and help them understand that this is about understanding a system? It's not obsessing about some KPI type of thing. So curious what you would say to that. What would be a chart that someone could start with?
That's a really good question. I have a lot of different ideas. You know, one thing, because it's so, you know, prevalent in our education systems pretty much across the United States is state test scores. Now, it's in some aspects, in some aspects, it's not the best thing to put in a chart because they typically only happen one time a year towards the end of the year. So it's hard to gather enough data to sort of use in practice on a day-to-day basis. On the flip side, I do think it's helpful to put something like state test scores, even though they only happen on an annual basis, in a control chart or a process behavior chart, because I think people forget, frankly, they forget what happened just a couple years ago in their system when it comes to state test scores. And so you see all these documents created all the way from state departments of education to individual schools that are marketing to parents in their area that basically are writing fiction about their test scores. We improved from last year. Well, yeah, technically maybe it went up 2%, but then it's down, you know, 5% from 2 years ago. And so I think plotting the dots to your test score data over 12 or 15 years gives a sense of how the data is bouncing around an average, probably.
Okay.
And not in a meaningful way, I think, in most circumstances. And I think allowing you to see those patterns is really important. And I think another sort of helpful layer to that is annotate that chart with things that have happened in either your school, your district, or even at a state policy level. Label when the test format changed. Label when the state standards changed. Label the year that what kids needed to do to be considered proficient, the cut score for the proficiency. Label when that changed, because these are all things that have happened in the last 5 or 6 years in most states, including Ohio, where I am. And when you start to label those things and then you see the ups and downs that are associated with those labels, you start to say, oh, this picture of what's been happening in my system makes a lot more sense. And most of that is completely sort of out of the picture for most people. We don't really remember what happened 3 or 4 years ago. Even if we have a general idea, we don't have it pinpointed to a specific year. When did we start testing on computers instead of paper and pencil? That's another example. Those all have impacts on test scores.
That's a great one for the administrators. What if you were in a classroom and you say I don't really have control over what goes on in my school so much, but I do enjoy this Deming journey and I want to start to bring some of that into my classroom, what would be one chart that you would make?
A couple ideas that come to mind, maybe two I'd share with you. One would be something like, you know, homework completion. What percent of the kids are doing, you know, either in class, or it doesn't have to be homework, it could be in class assignments. And I think the key here is, one, you have to operationally define what completion means, you know, and that can vary by classroom as long as everybody's on the same page. And then with that, put it up on the wall on a piece of chart paper. Because so often the things that we want kids to improve are hidden from them. They don't, oh, I didn't know that 35% of the kids in this class didn't do the assignment from the day before, right? But if they start to see that, and then we start to talk about it, and then we start to say, well, what are the barriers or obstacles to completion? And then kids start to say, well, how can I help you? You know, you start to create this completely different mentality in your classroom. One classroom also that we had in our network of schools, it was a fourth grade science teacher. She started tracking how much joy did you find in today's lesson. And so she would actually, the kids would do a short little survey and assign a number, you know, out of 100%. And then they would also have there was a spot in the survey to say, what did you like about it? What didn't go so well or whatever? What could I improve? This is the teacher saying that to fourth graders. And they're charting that on a piece of paper. And then she's starting to learn, okay, these types of lessons are engaging. These types of lessons are not so engaging. The kids want more of this. Enjoyment goes up when we do this as a class. And then they did that over the course of 3 or 4 months. And slowly over time, you see the engagement levels, the joy raising. Kids are happier. They're more engaged in class. The teacher's having more fun. And so, you know, those are just sort of two things that I've seen done in our network of schools that I think had a, you know, had a really positive impact.
That's exciting. And I think it goes back to the intrinsic versus extrinsic motivation. And ultimately, you know, kids want to be engaged.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to be engaged in what they're going through. And the reason why they disengage oftentimes is because we don't involve them.
Right. Yeah, I agree 100%. I mean, I think kids are really, students in schools are the improvement secret weapon. I mean, I think a mindset shift for me was when you think about in your system, who is the worker? And a lot of educators think, when you ask them that question, they'll say, well, teachers. And I think, you know, not that there's a right or wrong answer to this, but I think it's actually the students, because the thing that has to be created, high quality learning, has to happen in their minds, right? So if they're the ones where the work has to happen, they have to be the workers. So I think of students as the workers, and I think more of teachers as the supervisors of that work.
That's a great way to think about it, because it also kind of pushes it down to for the teachers to think that their objective is really creating that environment, you know, that for learning. I wonder, when you started bringing the Deming philosophy into schools and your operations there, was there one point that was like there was resistance to, or like what do you think is kind of the hardest to digest for a teacher's or school system when they're looking at this?
That's a really good question. You know, I think in my own sort of personal opinion, I think that a lot of the Deming philosophy is paradoxical to sort of typical management practices. And I think there's a lot of counterintuitive ideas in the philosophy. So I think you have to sort of be open to that from the start. And so when I first started talking with people about these ideas, I did it both internally and with some people externally. And I just put together a presentation and said, I'm going to show you this thing and I want to collect your thoughts. And one of the first things I said is, before I say anything, I want you to sort of have in your mind preemptively that you're going to experience some serious cognitive dissonance with these ideas, because they're so different than what you've heard before. So I did that as a primer. So people sort of had that expectation. I think generally what I find from folks is openness to the ideas. I think there's a challenge in sort of unpacking, going back to something like I was talking about with the Bosch grades, unpacking why exactly did he say what he said, whether it's the Bosch grades or any number of other points that he made. I think there's this sort of realization for a lot of people that when you say, well, what's your philosophy, or what's your educational philosophy, what's your management philosophy, they don't really have an answer. I didn't have an answer, frankly, before I started studying this stuff. And that's a little bit convicting. And then once you sort of decide to go on the journey, you sort of realize, why do we do the things that we do? You know, you could ask that about 1,000 things a day, you know, whether it's a policy, a practice, you know, just something we do because that's the way we've always done it here. And again, that's it's a little daunting when you start to think about, well, what is the underlying reason that we do this?
It kind of shakes the foundation of your.
Yeah, Yeah, shaking the foundation. So you have to be open to that. And I think that's where the no instant pudding sort of quote from Deming comes in, is that you really have to be committed to this. And, you know, I think of a story I read in a book, Henry Neve's book, The Deming Dimension, where he basically says, Ford engineer, a quality control guy, comes to a Deming seminar on, you know, 1 week, a 4 day seminar, goes back the following week. And, you know, he read the 14 points and one of them's about inspection and, you know, not relying or over relying on inspection. And he went the next week and fired all the inspectors in his plant. I think it was a Ford plant. Mm. And basically, you know, Henry Neve says that's not the right approach. Like, you have to understand why you're doing what you're doing first before you do it.
Right.
And you have to remember that that thing, in this case, it's inspection, is a part of your system. So you can't remove it before you understand why you're doing that and what you're going to replace it with. Mm-hmm. And that should probably happen deliberately and probably over time and not, you know, the next Monday after you've heard this idea. So it's a little of both. It's how do you start moving the needle, but then how do you do it thoughtfully with an underlying understanding of the theory under all of these?
Another ideas? Question is, if we think about the, you know, really you have to kind of, if you're bringing the Deming philosophy into a school as an example, you have to kind of convince administrators and you have to kind of, you know, let's say educate administrators. You got to educate the teachers. And also there's the kids. And I'm curious, what are the things that teachers really get from the Deming? Like, okay, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And let's strip away some of the complexity sometimes in the way that it's presented, but let's just take, you know, some of the basic principles. What are some of the things that the kids would naturally, you know, get? Like, that makes sense, you know, to them. I'm just curious what your observations have been there.
That's a really good question. How would I answer that? I mean, I think, you know, well, I start with myself first. I think, you know, because Deming talked about sort of an individual transformation has to happen as a precursor to like a larger organizational transformation. And so for me, it was starting to take many of the ideas I was reading and then think about application in my own life, maybe as a student myself. And as I did that and I thought through those things, I never came up against something that didn't make sense to me. I think the trick is, especially for adults, is that I think in a lot of ways, a lot of people would latch onto the ideas for themselves, but like this won't work for other people need something different. I think that's, you know, a good example is like performance appraisals. Like they've never been effective for me. I never have gotten great feedback from them, or I felt they're unfair, or, you know, I got rated on my use of technology in my classroom early in my career, but there were no working computers, right? But everybody else needs a performance appraisal. Yeah. So you come across a lot of stuff like that, I think, where you have to say, yep, that works for me in my life. And we have to take that same lesson and apply it to others. So that's one thing I think about. It wasn't the exact question you asked, but that's one thing I think about. I actually find, I mean, there's things to learn in terms of teachers, but I actually think a lot of teachers sort of have a natural inclination for the sort of general Deming perspective, Deming philosophy. I think things like rating, I think teachers would latch on to Deming's idea of abolishing grading. I think actually much faster than maybe administrators would in a lot of ways.
That would be a hard one. I remember when I went to my first Deming seminar and I was a young supervisor at a Pepsi factory in the U.S., and I appreciate that Pepsi put me into those seminars because it really, you know, helped, you know, me. And I think I brought back stuff to the Pepsi factory in Torrance, California. But the one thing that really struck a chord with me is I didn't realize I was operating within a system. Mm. I saw individual efforts of myself and others and everybody kind of running around trying to get things done. But I didn't see that the limitation on the output of our activity was to a large extent determined by the system within which we were operating. If we didn't have the resources, if we had an accounting department that was just trying to cut costs, and so we couldn't get the replacement parts for the machinery. Like, I didn't catch, I totally understood that once I, you know, studied Deming and learned about that. And so that's why I'm kind of thinking about, you know, what makes sense to teachers. So let's talk about kids for a moment. Like, what, you know, I think about joy in, you know, in work, as Deming says, and just the intrinsic motivation. And I think about kids, and I mean, they're just full of positive energy and rolling around. And, you know, there's just so much positive energy. And it's like the world just starts beating them down over time. You know, it's hard enough to overcome some of the challenges you're facing with your family, you know, at home. And then you come into a school and you've got to operate within this framework. And it's like, I suspect that kids would appreciate the idea of bringing joy to the classroom. But what have you seen from kids?
Well, I think you're onto something when you say, you know, as kids sort of go on in their educational career, a lot of times they're sort of beat down by certain aspects of the educational system. So I think one thing is there is a sort of there's a process to undo some of that. And that's probably what I see most, you know, with my own kids or you know, students that I'm working with in our network. So if you ask a student or if you ask your own kids something like, you know, how was school today? Or, you know, how are you doing in science? What they'll often tell you is a grade. Okay, you had a test today. How was it? Well, I got a B, right? Well, what did you learn? And oftentimes it's really hard to pull that out because they've been so sort of trained to think about school as sort of a series of grades or a series of assignments, you know, a series of percentages versus, you know, what did you learn? What are you taking from that? What does that mean? So I see a lot of that. I also see a lot of, you know, there's a lot of sort of a reward and punishment that is a part of a lot of school systems, whether it's, you know, treasure boxes or, you know, reward systems in the classroom. And I was just as guilty as a teacher. Mm. And frankly, as a principal when I led a school, of having those systems. But when you say, you know, at the end of the day, how was your day? And they sort of tell you back, you know, what they were doing in the behavior point system versus like, what did they learn? And, you know, who did they talk to that day? And what did they take from the day? I think you quickly realize that even if the, you know, the behavior system or the grading system had good intentions behind it, the kids are often experiencing those systems in a very different way. And so I think kids are very open to it, just like adults when you explain it. I think what's the tough part is that they've been in this system that has all of these different sort of things that are wearing them down. And I think you have to unpack that and untie that and sort of, you know, re-educate, I guess, retrain them to think about school and academics and how they're interacting in school in a different way.
It makes you think that students are the secret weapon of the implementation of some of this, because I think there's a lot of, at first when you come across the Deming material, it doesn't feel intuitive. It feels hard sometimes to understand. It can be confusing. But once you start to realize and understand it, you start to realize that, you know, there's a lot of intuitive nature of things. And, you know, a kid can observe random outcomes and then they see adults rewarding random. And then like, well, Johnny just got lucky, you know, in that particular thing or whatever. And so they can understand a lot of things. So maybe we can say that, you know, that there is a little bit of a secret weapon there. What?
Yeah. I mean, kids are very intuitive. And so I think in going back to, you know, some of those reward systems, I think one of the things that happens and we maybe don't pay enough attention to it, is as soon as there is a reward system, there's a game that starts. And so a good example of this is there's a number of online reading programs where kids read a book and then they take a quiz that sort of assesses comprehension. And on the face, it seems like a positive thing. Oh, kids have read X number of words. I'll hear this a lot, or X number of books. And they weren't reading before, and this program gets them to read. But when you start to unpack that, you go ask a kid, well, what do you think of this program? That's pretty boring, but I do get prizes. Or something like, well, I'm impressed. Like you've read, you know, 10 books in the past couple of months. And that seems to be because you were doing this program. And he's like, nah, I just pick short books because I know I can read them faster. And so as soon as you start to put those, you take sort of intrinsic nature of enjoying a book for the book's sake, for the story, and you instead tie it to some type of point system, there's all types of things, many of which are hidden, that are the motivations just under the surface for why kids are doing what they're doing that you're missing because you're not talking to them and not really listening to how they're responding to that reward system. So even a positive thing like a reading program that seems good on the face can often have sort of an underlying darker, you know, nature that's going on.
I want to wrap up this section of the discussion. And I think what I would like to wrap that up with is kind of taking on what you were just saying, is that when you are measuring anything and you find yourself wanting to add on additional measures because they're getting, you know, things are getting disincentivized. So, okay, now you say, okay, well, we've got to track it by the length of books, or we got to track their eyeballs, or we got to, you know, every time that you find yourself having to add on some different type of measurement, I think it's a good time to step back and say, what are we really doing here? And how, do we really understand the incentives that we're, you know, the activities that we're really incentivizing by this? And are we really getting to our goal of that? And that's a painful discussion because, as you say, you know, you're still sometimes going to you're going to have to search for what's the replacement, what's the solution. But when you find yourself trying to add on more things to try to box the kids in, you're probably now caught up in this system of, you know, testing and scoring and measuring that, you know, it's going out of control.
Yeah, I think that's right. And the thing that I think of, and I can't remember where I saw it, if it was a Deming thing or maybe I heard it from David Langford. Mm. It was a shift in perspective in terms of your role as a teacher, or if you're the CEO of a company or the principal of a school, whatever it is. Many of those folks, myself included at one point, when you ask them what their job is, many people tell you it's to motivate my students or motivate the people that work in my company. But probably a better frame is not to motivate them, but rather to remove the obstacles to them finding joy in learning or joy in work. Mm-hmm. And that's a different mindset, right? And so instead of incentivizing or coming up with different metrics in the case of that reading program, what I would be thinking about is, have I created a comfortable spot for kids to read in the classroom? Yeah. Is there a good supply of books with lots of different interesting topics? Have I talked to kids about what they're interested in reading? Have I carved out a time in the day where everybody is reading? And so then, instead of me pushing, now I'm removing obstacles that would prevent kids from reading in that example, and creating an environment that makes it much more likely that kids are going to enjoy it and want to keep doing it, you know, in an intrinsic fashion, rather than sort of trying to monitor extrinsically.
So let's wrap up by talking about what you've been working on. You've been writing, and, you know, maybe you can share where you're at and what you're producing. And then after that, I think we'll highlight to the audience what we're going to do in the future episodes. So maybe tell us about what you're working on and kind of where that's at, and then why you're doing it and what's the value that you think it can bring.
Yeah, I'm writing a book on applying Deming's ideas to schools. It's sort of the tentative title is Win-Win, W. George Deming, the System of Profound Knowledge and the Science of Improving Schools. So I've actually found a publisher and completed a draft and submitted it to them. And so we're working right now on getting the book published. And so I'm hoping by the end of the school year, that'll be out and published and available for folks. So that's the big thing I've been working on. I actually started in September of 2020. So it's been quite the project to bring it from sort of just an idea to an almost published project. So hopefully soon that'll be ready.
And I think that's that leads us into, you know, you and I are going to have some conversations about that book and about the things that you're learning and teaching throughout that. And we'll have a series that we'll be going through, which I'm excited to learn from you. I mean, I have, you know, businesses, but and I apply Deming's thinking in business, but also I'm a teacher. So I enjoy everything that I can learn from, you know, people like yourself and David. And I know the audience will learn. So let me ask one last question, and that is, why Deming and why now? Why is it important that it's Deming, and why is it important that we are looking at this now?
That's a really good question. I would say, you know, I consider myself a learner. I read a lot. I watch a lot. I listen to a lot of podcasts. And across my 20 years, you know, I've never found anything quite like the Deming philosophy. You know, you sort of search for these magic or silver bullets, and they really don't exist. But the Deming philosophy really has been that thing for me, because I think what I didn't realize is the importance of an underlying philosophy for then everything else that you're doing. And that foundation is what the System of Profound Knowledge has really provided to me in my work. And I also mentioned, as I thought through the ideas pretty deeply and wrote about those ideas in the book, every time I had some dissonance initially with the Deming idea, and then I put it in my own life, I worked it out and said, yep, no, that he was exactly right. How he thought about, you know, how we interact in our organizations, how we interact with each other. Mm. And so not that the dissonance has gone away, not that I understand all of the ideas perfectly, but every time I've tested it and tried to falsify the philosophy or the theory, I haven't been able to do it. And there's nothing else that I can say that I've worked with that has held up to that scrutiny like this philosophy.
Fantastic. Well, John, on behalf of everyone at the Deming Institute, I want to thank you again for coming on the show. And I wonder, do you have any parting words for our audience?
Yeah, I think one of my favorite Deming quotes is really short and to the point. He said, I make no apologies for learning, right? And I think that's a really good a way to end the conversation. And what I meant by that was, you know, you might have not have been doing it right before, but there's this opportunity to learn this new way. And that's sort of the opportunity that I've taken as I've discovered Deming's work.
And that concludes another great story from the worldwide Deming community. Remember to go to deming.org to continue your journey. This is your host, Andrew Stotz, and I'll leave you with my favorite quote from Dr. Deming, and that is, people are entitled to joy in work.